So yesterday we learned about NumPies. So the best thing what we can do in NumPy is to create an n-dimensional arrays. Welcome to Pandas. Pandas is an open source BSD library that provides high performance, easy to use data structures and analysis tools for Python programming language. So this is the line that you'll find in any of the books that you are reading for Pandas, like the go-to line to define Pandas. So in basic, what is Pandas? Pandas is nothing, just to create data frames. Because when you get a data from any CSV file or any external data source, we want to keep it into a way so that we can access, we can change the data, we can manipulate the data in an easier way. If we'll put it in NumPy array, if we'll put it in list, it's gonna be really hectic for us to handle because list are nothing like what, just group of datas, not they're not properly organized. Arrays are more organized as compared to list, but they're not very much organized, that much organized that we want. But in Pandas, you can organize the data into a proper, like what? Actual Excel kind of a sheet. So this is what Pandas is used for. Okay, let me just enlarge this thing so that I can. Okay, so we'll go through what is data frames, what is data series, and the different operations in Pandas. And again, I'll tell you the operations that I'm going to tell you in Pandas, it's not limited to that. Pandas itself has so many operations which you can perform. It's like just to get to know what all Pandas can do, you can have a full month of class. But we'll only go through the stuff which we're gonna use most number of times. There are some stuff which you'll see in the further classes which you haven't seen here. So that's what the function of Pandas is, that so many numbers of operations are there that you cannot like remember each and every one of them. So we'll go through the one which are like really important and which you'll come across each and every day. So as NumPy, we saw that to import NumPy, we use import NumPy as np. To import pandas, we write import pandas as pd. So again, this is an alias. You can give anything you want. Now, first thing, to create a data frame. To create a data frame, we need to provide the data for which we have to create the frame. And then we have to provide the index and the columns. Now we'll see how exactly we create a data frame. So pandas has a proper function which is known as data frame, which will take the data as an input. Like as an input, it'll take the data and it'll create a data frame. Now what we did, to give a data, we create an array. Now to create a data frame, it's not necessary that you have to give only a NumPy array or only a list. You can give any kind of data. You can literally pass the whole what CSV file or a JSON file to it to create a data frame. But just for examples kind of sake, I'm showing the NumPy array. So yes, last class, if you remembered, np.arrange, we got 0 to 24 numbers, which we're going to reshape into 6 is to 4. It means we have a numbers of 0 to 24, 0 to 24, which is reshaped into 6 rows and 4 columns. And now there are two parameters which you can provide in data frame, which is known as index and columns. So index goes as the name. So this index will create the index of the data frame, like which all index which you want, like row 1, row 2, row 3, row 4, row 6, which you can create. Columns will give the name of the columns which you want to provide. Now just remember, if you have given the reshape as 6 into 4, it means it has 6 rows and 4 columns. So you have to provide 6 row names and 4 column names. You can see 4 column names. So if I'll execute this line, okay, sorry, I didn't with the first one only. Try df for now. Okay, just hold on. Okay. So now you have seen we created a data frame using 0 to 24 numbers, which is reshaped into 6 rows and 4 columns, which provide the index and the column. So we can see if we write df and print it, we got 6 rows, 4 columns. And again, remember, we have to take care of the size that we are providing. If we have, as you have seen, 6 rows are there, so we have to provide 6 row names. If I'll just delete one of them, just delete one of them and try to execute, it's not going to execute because shape of the parse array is 6 into 4, which implies, and the indexes are implying it to be 5 into 4. So make sure that the row numbers that you're providing is accurate. Now we put the data. Now if you want to see the data ahead, Now there are two functions which is known as head and tail. You can see head. Now what head does is, head is gonna take the first five rows of the data frame and gonna display it. As you can see, the first five rows are displayed. Tail does what? If I'll go for tail, tail displays the last five rows of the data frame. As you can see, the last five rows, 6, 4, 5, 3, 2. Now, we can provide the number of, let's see, HED, we can provide the number of rows that you want to see in your data frame. Just imagine we want to see only the first three rows. So we can provide df that head and 3. So it will only show the first three rows. If you want to see df of like all the 10 rows, if you want to see 10 rows, it only show you 6 because the max is 6. So if you give any number which is more than the number of rows existing in your data frame, it's going to show all of them. It's not going to give you an error. And if it's nothing is passed, so the default is 5 rows. Now, as simple as that, no hard frame is this. Now, how to access the data? To access the data, we have two functions, which is known as lock and iloc. So first we'll go for lock. Just imagine we remove this for now. As you can see, lock stands for location. So if you want to access any data frame using the column names or if they're row names, you can do what? You can just use the function df.lock and provide the row or the column name. As you can see, I provided df.lock and show me row 2. So you can see row 2 has 4, 5, 6, and 7. So you got the output as column 1 has 4, column 2 has 5, column 3 has 6, column 4 has 7. Now, if we'll try to find out what is the type of this particular data, if we'll try to find out what is the type of this particular data, we'll go for type. You can see it is a series. It is not a data frame, it is a data series. Now, I'll tell you what is the difference between data frame and data series a bit later. Now, we can see if we want to see row 2, the data came. Now, if you want to see row 2 and row 3, both, what we'll do, we just write row 3. Okay, but you get an error. Now, why you get an error is, if you're providing only one row, like only one attribute inside the location attribute, it's fine. But if you want to provide more than one, if you have to provide 2, 3, 4, and 5, we have to input them as a list. So if you want to provide 2 or more than 2, we have to give them inside a list. So we're just making it as a list. Now execute it, we got 2 and 3. Now if we'll try to find out the type of this, it's a data frame. So what is the exact difference between data frame and data series is, data frame is collection of data series, that's it. So if a data, any data has more than one number of rows or more than one number of columns, it is known as a data frame. But if the data has only one row, like just imagine this row has only one row or only one column, so we'll go for data series. It's a data series. Now we consider, like, we access the data using using rows. Now we'll access the data using columns. I guess now it's microphone, so we'll come back to the class. Now we're gonna access the columns. Let's see the column spellings, right? Okay, let's don't try this again. Okay. So know about what is the difference between data frame and data series. Now, we learned about data frame, data series, and how to access it using location. Now, if you want to access using the index number, like you do not exactly know, like the name is column 1 or column 2, we just want to know, like, what is the first row, what is the first column, what is the second column, we'll go for iloc. Iloc stands for index location. So instead of giving the row as row 1 or row 2, we just give input as numbers. We remove the type. Let's see. So we got the first row, like the first second row, because the all indexing start from 0. So second row and third row, as you can see. So this is what data frame and data series are. Now, if you want to access the exact, like last class where I told you how to exactly extract the like what a portion of a data. Portion of a data from an array. So how to extract a portion of a data from a data series. So I guess you have, if you're attending the last class, you have you remember this particular syntax. So it's exactly similar to how you access the data into an array, that the comma separates the rows and the columns. The colon separates the starting row and the starting row, the starting and the ending point. So currently in this particular function, we haven't specified anything. So if we haven't specified anything, by default it will take the starting of the row, starting of the column, and the ending of the row, and the ending of the column. Now if we'll execute this particular line, you can see the whole row, the whole data frame as it is. Now if we want to just change it, like we want to show all rows but only column number 1, 2, and 3, like not 0, 1, 2, and 3 only. So we execute this line. So you can see we haven't specified the number of rows. It means it's going to take all number of rows, but we specified that start the column from index 1 till the end. So we can see column 1 has been removed, only column 2, 3 and 4 came. Now if you want to see only column 2 and 3, so we have to limit it till, limit it till 3. So we can only see column 2 and 3 are here. If you want to see only row 1, 2 and 3, so starting from 0, from till 3 you want to see. So 0, 1, 2, and 3. So it's exactly similar to how we're using arrays. Okay. Now, if you have a data frame and we want to convert it into a NumPy array, it's like we don't generally do it, but there are situations in which you want to create, like change the data which are saved in the data frame into an array. So you have a proper function which is known as dot values. So what that values will do, it will just going to take the data inside the data frame and it will convert into an array. So if we just give the whole data set, like df.iloc, the whole data set has been the dot values. So it's just going to give you an array. An output is an array which has all the data which is given into the data frame as an array. As simple. Now we do not have to give this iloc also, because why do you? Same thing. So we provide the whole data frame and convert it into a array. So you created an array. Now if you want to save it somewhere, then just make a variable and just save it into wherever you want. Now the data set is there. Now there are some special functions which will be really helpful to get to know what exact kind of data is being saved inside your data frame. Now this function, which is called as value count, value counts finds the frequency or the frequency of all the attributes or all the items which is in saved into your data frame. So we can see this is column 1. Column 1 has 0, 4, 8, 12, 16 and 20. So value counts will do what? It will go through each and every attribute of the, sorry, each and every item of the column 1. It will try to find out the number of counts, like number of occurrences of each and everything. So we can see it's providing 20 has been occurred only once, 12 has been occurred only twice, 12 occur only once, 4 only once, 16 only once, 8 only once, 10 only once. So similar thing. As you can see, there's no repeated thing. But imagine if they're like in row 8, row 3 and row 4, there's 8 and 8. So it would have been showing what 8 has been occurred 2 times. So this is what value counts will do. It is going to go and check the data that you're providing, and it is going to check the frequency of each and every unique attributes. Now, if you want to check like what is unique, like we don't want to know the number of counts, how they are, how much they are, but we just want to know how many unique actors are there. So we have a proper attribute which is known as unique. So we can see df column.unique. So this array will give you all the unique character that is present in this particular column. So we can see that this particular row or this particular data set doesn't have any repeated numbers. So that's why it's printing all the numbers. But if there are repeated numbers, unique will ignore that. It will only show the repeated columns. Sorry, only the unique columns. So this is what different functions of data frame are. Now we'll go through some of the real stuffs. Because when you are working with machine learning, like when you are making a project, it's not like you're gonna get a data set by yourself. Like you're gonna create a data set by yourself. It will be given to you as a CSV file. Like there are different formats, even an Excel file, many files are there. Most of the most common is a CSV file. So CSV stands for comma separated values. So a CSV file is nothing. It just keeps the data into a proper like text format or any kind of format which you want it to be, and it's gonna separate each and every value using commas. So that's why the name comma separated value came. So we have a file which is known as mercedes-benz.csv. The file has been in my PC. So to read a file, which any CSV file, we use a function which is known as read.csv. Now there are, as I told you can get either a CSV file or a TSV file or a JSON or many things. So if we go and try to find out how many, okay, let me see if I can show you. It will take a bit of time. Okay, so you can see how much availability of options are there. To read for a file, you can use read CSV, read Excel, read Feather, read FWF, read GWB. There are like many things which you can do. Read SQL table, SQL query, read option, read the table. You can have so many stuff. So currently we're working with read CSV. And most of the time when you're working with machine learning, you're gonna, like 99% of the time, you're gonna work with CSV files. There are rare occurrences in which you have to use a JSON or even an HTML file you can have to extract. So currently we're working on CSV file. Now we took a CSV file, which is Mercedes-Benz CSV, and we'll see what is exactly in that particular file. So it has 4,209 rows and 378 columns. The 4,209 rows, as you can see, the rows are there. The 378 columns are ID, the Y attribute, X naught attribute, X1 attribute till X385. Now these are the attributes and these are the rows. Now what all we can do to find out the information about your data frame, like what all, like rough idea of what the data frame has, we have an attribute called df.info. So if we'll execute the df.info, what you get is we'll get the data frame, like it's a data frame. We'll get to know what is the entries, like how many entries are there, like exactly how many number of rows are there. It says that it has 4,209 entries ranging from 0 to 4208. Columns, it will tell you the number of columns, which is from ID to X385. So ID to X385 means it'll tell you the name of the first attribute, sorry, first column and the last column. So you can see ID is the first column and then X385 is the last column. And it will tell you the data types. So you can see out of the 378 columns, 369 columns are of integer type, 8 columns are of object type, and 1 column is a float type. And the memory that it is using is 12.1 plus MB. It means it's 12.1 as a base, and depending upon the data, like depending upon the, what do you say, operations that you're doing, it's gonna exceed. So the base memory usage is 12.1 MB. So all those data is taking 12.1 MB or into your RAM. Now, if you want to know more about your data, like okay, this much is not enough, you want to know more. So we'll write one more thing. Let's remove includal for now. Df.describe. So what df.describe will do for each and every column, like for each and every row, it's gonna give you the count, mean, standard deviation, minimum, 25, 50, and 75 percentile. Just remember, it's not percentage, it's percentile. Okay, it's percentile and max. So for each and every column, it's gonna give you the count, mean, standard deviation, minimum, 25, 50, and 75 percentile and the maximum. And if you go through this particular data set, you can see from here, you can see there's X0, X1, X2, X3 till X385. Here you can see it starts from X10. It doesn't have X1 to X9. So the reason is df.describe only works on numerical datas. So you can see X0, X1, X2 have categorical data like A, K, AZ, 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 or any kind of data which is not numerical. So if it's not numerical, it's not gonna give you the output. Like if the columns doesn't have in integer data, it's not gonna get you an output. So you can see from X10 till X38 till wherever it is, like till 385, you have integer data. So for them, it's gonna give you the count, minimum, and all the attributes. Now, if you wanna see some information about the categorical data also, like we don't want to leave the x1 and x2 which are in category, which are in categorical data. So what we do, so we give an attribute which is known as include all. So what include all will do, it will include each and every one, each and every column. As you can see, x1, x2, and x3 all came. Now, you know, for a categorical data, finding the mean, median, 25 percentile, 50 percentile is not possible. So for all those things, you'll get a value which is known as not a number. So now, if you'll see NaN, it means not a number. Because for a categorical data, you can't find the mean, standard deviation, mean, minimum, and maximum, and any percentile. So for everything in this particular column, you'll get not a number. But for categorical data, it gives some of the information which is known as unique, top, and frequency. So unique tells you, out of all the in this particular, if you see in x naught, you can see x naught is here. So out of all the values which are present in x naught, how many unique numbers are there, like how many unique categories are there, which is the topmost, like which one has been occurred most number of times, and how many number of times. As you can see, x naught has total 4209 because it's the number of rows. The unique, there are 47 unique elements in x naught. The top is z, it means that z has been occurred most number of times, and the frequency is 360. It means 360 z occurred 360. In the x1, there are like 27 unique elements. AA has been occurred most number of times, and how many number of times exactly it has been occurred is 833. So this is what exact data you get for categorical data. And you can see, you cannot find this particular unique top in frequency for any numerical data. So for numerical data, you'll find all this particular function, all this particular columns as blank. And for categorical data, you'll find all this particular function, all this particular attributes as blank. So this is what df.describe does. Now, we have a particular function which is known as value counts. Where the fuck? Okay, so we'll go for value counts. So what value counts will do, as I have shown you here also, where is value counts? Okay, I removed here. Let me just write value counts. Value counts will just go, okay, I haven't executed the function or what? Okay. So my mistake, df has been changed. So what value counters will do, it will go through each and every attribute of the column, and it will gives you the frequency of the occurrences. So same here it will happen. Let me execute this particular function. Now df.x11. So what it is showing, that in this particular x11, you have only attribute 0, and it is 4209 times. If I'll go for x0, okay, so it's x0. So for x0, you can see it will show you each and every unique elements which are present in x0 and the number of time it has been occurred. So you can see z has been occurred 360 times, ak has been occurred 349 times, Y as 324 times, AY as 313 times. So it will give you the each and exact number of occurrences of each and every unique data in the column. So this is as simple as that. Now, remember if I told you about the data, about the arrays which I explained yesterday, we can also use the logical operations. Like, we also want to know, out of df.y, this particular y column, how many attributes are greater than 100. So if I'll execute this, you get from 0 to 4208, means all the number of rows, which is 4209 columns, how many are greater than y and how many are less than y. Sorry, how many are greater than 100 and how many are less than 100. So you can see the answer are false, 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 or true, true, true. It means this particular row is true. It means for this particular row, this particular condition has been satisfied. It means the value of y is greater than 100 for the first row. If we'll see the first row, so we can see the first row is 130. It means it's greater than 100. So you got the answer as true. We'll go for the second row. Let's see what is second row. Second row is 88. It is less than 100. So for that, we get the answer false. So similarly, you got all the answers as true and false. Now, if you want to see the exact data, we don't want true and false. We want to see the exact data. What we do? We provide this particular condition as an input of a data frame. We print it. So now we can see. Now we can see only those rows for which the value of y is greater than 100 has been printed. So you can see row first, row one has been printed. Row fifth has been printed, row seventh has been printed. So only the rows for which the value of y is greater than 100 has been printed and nothing else, which we're going to use many number of times in the machine learning algorithm, which is known as correlation. So df.cor is a function which finds the correlation between each and every attribute or each and every column. So you can see it gives you an output of same rows and columns. As you can see, ID, Y, X10, X11. Again, df.correlation only works on numerical data. You cannot make it to work on categorical data because I'll tell you what exactly correlation is. Now, it only works on numerical data. So you can see ID, Y, X10, X11, X12. ID, Y, X10, exactly the number. What is the rows? They're exactly the number of what that is exactly the columns are. Now you can see they are random numbers, which is in like, and it is always going to oscillate between -1 to 1. And you can see for each and every similar like similar attribute, which is like ID to ID, it's 1. Y to Y, it's 1. X10 to X10, it's 1. X11 to X11, it's 9. Because X11 is, what is X11? Okay, maybe X11 doesn't have a, okay, X11 is an object, I guess. That's why it has 9 values. So that's why it has 9 values, because it's an object. Now let me just go back and show you what exactly correlation is. So what is exactly correlation? Correlation gives you what exact relation exists between two attributes. Like taking x is equal to y square, it means there is a square relation between x and y, or x is equal to log y. So there's a logarithmic relation between x and y. So what is the number specifies that how high or how hard the correlation is. Imagine if we have a correlation of 1, it means the correlation of 1 means for each and every change in this particular attribute, as you can see ID is ID and ID, it means they both are the exact same attribute. It means if two attributes of any two columns have correlation of 1, it means for each and any change in column 1 will affect the same in column 2. Like imagine for column 1, for if we did anything and the column changed 3 times, even in the column 2, it's going to change 3 times. Exactly the same thing will happen in both the columns if the correlation is 1. Now, we will in the machine learning thing, machine learning models will never get a correlation of 1 unless and until you're comparing with the exact attribute. Like we can see ID and ID compared, we got a correlation 1. It means most of it, like 99.9% of the time, you'll never get a correlation of 1. Maybe you're doing a project or you got a data set in which two of the attributes are exactly similar. Other than that, you'll never get a correlation of 1. So the correlation of 1 means there will be an exact changes in between those attributes. Now we can see attributes which are like negative and positive. So what negative and positive implies? A positive correlation means for any increment in, like, just imagine we have x and y. Let me show you. Okay, just imagine x12 and id. So we can see it's a positive correlation from x12 to id. So it means for any positive increment in x12, we'll have a positive increment in id also. If we have a positive increment in id, we're going to have a positive increment in x12. We're not telling the exact number, because for id and id, if there's a correlation of 1, it means for exact changes in ID, it's gonna do the exact changes in the second ID, because they are exactly the same, because we cannot exactly talk about ID and ID. Just imagine we have X12 and ID as correlation 1. Just imagine X12 and ID as correlation 1. It means what changes will happen in ID, exact changes will happen in X11. But that's not possible, because of, like, most of the time it's not gonna be possible. So if we have a positive correlation, it means the changes which are happening in ID, if it's increasing, X2 is also increasing. if id is decreasing, x12 is also increasing. And if there is a negative correlation, it means if id is increasing, x12 or x14 is decreasing. As you can see, x14 and id has a negative correlation. It means if id is increasing, x14 is decreasing, or if x14 is increasing, id is decreasing. So that's what the significance of the symbol. If the positive correlation, one's increment will go through for the other's increment, and if the correlation is negative, it means one increments is helping for others decrement. And if the number suggests, what is the magnitude? If the magnitude is 1, it means there's a high correlation. Like for each and exact change, there will be a high change in the other attributes. As you can see, for this particular one, it is positive. It means the same correlation, but x12 and id has a correlation of 0.05. It means for any small change, like for really high changes of id, it's gonna affect x12 really less because the correlation is 0.05. So for a high change in id, you can have a really low change in x12. If the value is more, like the value is 0.8 or 0.9, in that condition, more changes in id will affect in more changes in x12. So that's what correlation is. You'll get to know about more about correlation when we'll go like come across more stuff about correlation in machine learning models. Just for now, just have an idea that correlation just tells you the exact relation between two attributes. If it's positive, it means for any's increment, the other is gonna increment. If it's a decrement of one attribute, it's gonna decrement for the other attribute. If it's negative, it's gonna be the other way around. So that's what correlation is. You can see there are like lots of numbers here. So most of the time, if you're gonna use correlations in machine learning models, we don't go for the exact this particular numbers. We try to implement it using any graph so that we'll have a color combination or a color codes so that we can find out the exact correlations. So this is what correlation it is. Now, x11 of value counts as I've showed. So x11 has only 0. If we'll change it to what? X0, I've showed you this also. That's gonna give number of Z, number of AK, like how many times it has been occurred. Now, we're making a data frame with not a number values. Now, just imagine we made a list. One, two, three, three, four, np.nan. np.nan stands for not a number. So if you want to put a data, like put a not a number value inside a data frame, we use np.nan. It's just a representation of an object which is not a number. We don't want to put zero or any string. We just want to put not a number attribute. So we can see np.nan. Because if you want to remove some data from the data frame, because most of the time if you'll work on real-time data, you're not going to get a whole structured data. Most of the chances that the data has been missing, or the data that you want to work on, that's been missing, or it has been tampered, or because it's been kept for a long time, some of the data are not even existing. So what we do for that particular cases, we just change this to np.nan so that we have different functions to handle nan like not a number functions. So we make a data frame using this particular list data. We can see the df.health shows 1, 2, 3, 3, 4, nan, 5, 6, nan. So we can see nan functions are there. Now, handling missing values. This is one of the most important functions of data analysis. Okay, some data analysis. Because when you're building any machine learning model, like more than 50% of the time of any project work, it will take you only in your data handling, that how to make your data, like the data that you got from the market or the data that you got from the external resources, how to make it compatible for your machine learning model. More than 50% of the time it will go on the handling of the data, like how to make it proper. And in that, one of the most important thing is handling missing values, that the value is only missing, it doesn't exist there. And you cannot just put any blank data inside your machine learning model. The data that the machine learning model needs to train on itself, it has to be completely structured, and it has to be in that particular way in which the model needs it to be. We'll see in the machine learning algorithms, like what exact model, like what exact data types they want inside them, like as an input, but the only thing which is common for each and every one of them, they're not gonna accept any missing values or zero values or like not a number values. So for that, we have to handle the data. Now, just imagine this is what we got. Just execute this. This is what we got. Okay, now we can see there are like so many random NAND values are there, which is not going to be useful for any other machine learning model. So what we can do, we can drop the NAND values. Now, if we write df.dropNA, drop NA stands for drop NAND. So all the rows or all the columns which is specified, if it's access 0, it's just going to remove all the rows which have NAND values. You can see first row has no NAND values. Second row, third row, and fourth row has NAND values. So if I'll execute this particular line, you can see all the rows for which NAND values are present has been excluded. And if we don't want to remove the number of rows, and we don't want to remove rows, we want to remove the columns only. We just have to write access 1. So access 1 stands for columns. Access 0 for rows, access 1 for columns. So if we'll do that, we can see the first column has no NAND values. The first column remains, and all the columns for which NAND values are there has been removed. So this is what df.dropNA does. Now, if you'll execute this and this. Now, df.dropNA will just gives you the output of like, this is our exact data frame. If we drop the not a value numbers with the access 1, this is what our data set will look like. It didn't change the exact df. The df is still going to be, again, if we'll print df, just going to be the same. It hasn't been changed. It just gives you the definition It just gives you a view of what will happen if you use this particular drop NA function with access 1. This will be your output. If you want to save this thing, like we want to save this particular output in df, we have a parameter which is known as in place dot true. So if we'll write in place dot true, execute this thing. So same thing happened, but now this time df has been changed. So what output which we are getting from this function has been overridden for df. So now df has without not a number values. So the output that we got from this particular function has been overridden by df. As simple as that. Now, okay. Now, this is what you do for missing values. So there are like many different functions which you can use for missing values. It's not like you always have to drop the missing values. You can fill the missing values with like mean or average or anything. It completely depends on you, like how you are thinking your data set to be. Now, we make a data frame using np.random.random, as I've shown you many times. What exactly random.random does is it's gonna get the data and gives you random values. We give the index abcdefgh and columns are 1, 2, 3. So the data has been created. Data set has been created. Now, reindex is a function which gives new indexes to a existing data frame. As you can see, for this particular function, so this particular data frame, we have A, C, E, F, and H, F and H as a row. Reindex can give you new indexes. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. We give all the alphabets. Now, what it will do, it will create all the indexes, and if the index exist in df, like we can see A exists in df, so it will copy the data, and if it doesn't exist in df, it will give a NAND value for each and everything. So we can see A, C, E, F, and H, they all have the data existing in df. So A, C, E, F, and H has the data in the data frame, but B, D, and G didn't have the data in the first data frame, so they got the NAND values. That's what reindex does is. So the function is just to give new indexes. Now, if you want to remove the data, like now we have the data frame, you want to remove all the rows for which there's NAND values. So what we do, df2.dropNA, access 0. Access 0 means just remove all the rows for which there are not a number of values. We execute this thing. Execute this. So all the rows for which there are NAND numbers have been removed. Now, if you want to just search, like we do not want to like the moment we'll get your data, it's not like we know that there is not a number of values, like there are missing values. For that, we have a function which is isNA. What isNA does is it's going to find in your data frame that there is any data frame, like any missing values are there or not. So we provided df2.1. It means df2.1. This is a df2.1. Okay. For this, we have NAND numbers or not. So what we got is for row A, false. It means for df1, row A, we have a proper number. It's not empty. So we got a false. For B, we have a empty value, which is none. So for that, we got true. So similarly, what p.isNA did, just going to give you the output that the existing data frame that you're providing as a parameter has the NaN numbers or not, like NaN attributes, like NaN objects, what you can call, anything you can call. Now, what isNA does, not NA does exactly the same, exactly the opposite. So it's going to find if it doesn't contain the NaN numbers or not. So we can see not NA. So if we'll go and check df2.1 and A, df2.1 and A. So there is a proper number existing. So for not NA, you got in true. For second, not a number. To what isNA does will be done by not NA. So it's completely depend on you what exactly output you want it to be. For not a number you want to print true, or for not a number you want to print false, it's completely depend on you. The exact function of isNA and not NA is exactly the same, to find out that there is a not a number attributes or not. Now we have a proper function which is known as fillNA. So what fillNA does is it will go through each and every place of your data frame, and it will change it will remove the not a number attribute and it will place any object that you're providing. So now you can see df2.fillNA, we provide the object missing. So what it will go through df2, it will find each and every place where not a number is there. Like you can see not a number object is there. So for each and every place where not a number object is there, it's going to place it with missing. As you can see, for all the numbers, missing has been there. You can provide anything. You can provide a proper number. Give one. So A, B, or wherever not a number was there, it replaced it with 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. And now again, we'll tell you, df2.fillNA, just going to give you a view. It's not updating df2. If you want to update df2, in place.true, as I've shown you. Okay, in place.true, as you can see, if we'll do only in place.true, only then df will get overwritten, or any of the data frame that you're providing will get overwritten. Currently we're not where it's gone. Currently you can see we're not providing in place.true, so it's just gonna give you a view. It's not changing df2 remains as it is. If we'll see df2, like what exactly df2 it is, we print df2, it's gonna be the same. It's never changed. It's just gonna give you the output like what it is. So this is what df2. Now if you wanna, like as I've told you, values, what values does this dot value does is it's gonna take your data frame and gonna create it into a create into an array. Just imagine we do not want to create the whole data frame into an array. We just want to create only a one row or one column. We can specify that what exact row or what exact column we want to create into a array, as we have specified, like df.1. This particular row should be created into an array. So what we did, we just provided this particular attribute like df.1 and gave the function df.values. So you got an array with this particular numbers. As simple as that. So this is what pandas is. So now the thing about pandas is it's not limited to this much. Pandas is way more than I have explained to you right now. You can have many functions existing in pandas which you'll come across. Go through the file name where I've called the mercedes.file. So you can see df is equal to pt.read.csv mercedes-benz.csv. So for this particular attribute, so this particular variable, we have mercedes-benz data. We can just create one more, like, sorry, we don't want to execute it, like df2, we just have pd.readcsv and just provide any other data, like provide any other name or any other CSV file. So you have df is taking care of this particular data, and any other object will, any other variable will take care of any other object will take care of any other data. So just the way you create different number of variables, it's gonna be same. And df equal to p dot data frame. Okay, let me show you where is data frame. Okay, so pd dot data frame. So what data frame does is, it's the basic function to create a data frame using PyPandas. So what data frame wants is the data, the indexes, and the number of columns, like what columns names are there and what rows names are there. So np dot arrange dot reshape. In yesterday's class, I told you what is np dot arrange dot reshape. It's going to create an array with reshape into 6 into 4. So what we got? Np dot array, which is 0 to 20, 0 to whatever. Like, let me show all the rows. Okay, let me execute all the thing. Okay, so all those arrays are there, reshaped into 6 rows and 4 columns. And if it's 6 rows and 4 columns, you have to provide 6 rows as their 6 rows names and 4 columns as their 4 column names. If you change it, like if you'll make it less, like if you're only giving 5 rows, it's going to give you an error that the data that you're providing is 6 into 4, but the indexes that you're applying is 5 into 4. So make sure that the data that you're providing and the rows and columns that you're providing should. Is any? Okay, so pt dot is any. So what we are providing, we can do one more thing instead of making yourself a bit confused. I guess is any works here. Okay, so what is any does is, it's gonna take the data frame or data series that you're providing, and it's gonna check that is the data frame consist non-nan objects or not. So you can see df2 of 1. So this is particular column that you're checking. Is any will check if it has nan objects or not. So for row A, it shows false. It means for row A, it doesn't have nan attribute, nan object. You can see A has 0.02. It's a proper number, not a nan attribute. So it shows false. If it's we can see for row second, it's nan. It means it's going to give you a true value, and it's giving you a true value. For C, it's false because it has a proper number. For D, it's going to give a true value, and for D, it's giving a true value. So this is NA, for which one you're asking, and fill NA. Now, if I'll show you about fill NA. So there's nothing speciality in fill NA. So what will fill NA do? Will provide the data set, or if you want to specify exactly, like, just do it in one, many. Okay, so df2.1, just give this particular data and do the changes of fill NA to one. It means it will go through the data set which you provided, and wherever it will find the nan object, it will replace it with any of the attribute that you're providing. For this particular case, we are providing value one. It means for each and every place where nan was, as you can see, df2.notNA. If I'll just print it, df2.1 here for now, we can see A has a proper number, B has nan object, C has a proper number, D has non object. If we use fill NA, so for every places where nan was there, it's going to be replaced with 1, 1. If you provided with 2, like any random, like 25, execute. We got for each and every places where nan was there, we provided with 25. Okay, so any other thing which you want to know? Most of this file, yeah, you will get it. I guess everyone is happy with the answers. If everyone is done, you can just type yes in the chat so that I can disconnect the call. Cool. Cool. What is the default index value? It's compulsory to specify index. It's not compulsory. The thing about the thing with the data frame is, if you not specify the index's name, it's just going to take 0, 1, 2 for rows and 0, 1, 2 for columns. But if you want to give them a proper name, you have to specify the indexes and columns. tomorrow's topic is gonna be panda has been done, so it's gonna be I guess matplotlib. Okay, I guess everyone is happy now. So thank you for attending this session. I will send this particular notebook and the CSV file in the group, and as usual this particular recording will be there in Skype, so if anyone want to refer it again you can just refer this thing, and if you have any doubt you can text me on WhatsApp or text me in the group. I'll happy to reply. I'll not be available from 5 to 6 because I have to give my college examination, so out of 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. I'll not be available. After that I'll be available. Okay then. Bye everyone.